وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: وقضى ربك ألا تعبدوا إلا إياه وبالوالدين إحسانا إما يبلغن عندك الكبر أحدهما أو كلاهما فلا تقل لهما أف ولا تنهرهما وقل لهما قولا كريما واخفض لهما جناح الذل من الرحمة وقل رب ارحمهما كما ربياني صغيرا.
All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, alhamdulillah, I titled my khutbah today at the Wallawat Jum'ah Masjid as my beloved mother and my beloved father. And alhamdulillah, we spoke about an individual's rights unto his parents. We spoke about the importance of one's parents. We spoke about how important it is to be good in conduct towards one's parents. And I thought it all the more appropriate to talk along the same vein in today's short talk too, as all of us, we are gathered to witness a nikah ceremony between two spouses who are about to begin a new chapter in their lives. So it is important for them as well as us to understand how important one's rights towards his or her parents are. And also so that we do not become an evil sign from the signs of the day of Qiyamah, as taught to us by our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It has been recorded in many books of ahadith, such as Bukhari, Muslim, and in the book of Imam Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Ibn Hibban, and many other books, this famous hadith, known as the hadith of Jibreel, alayhi salatu wasalam. Due to constraint of time, I'll not go into the full length of the hadith, but nevertheless, a man comes towards the gathering of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sits by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In that very narration, the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, especially Umar radiallahu anhu, who is the narrator of the hadith, he describes about this man, a man who is wearing a sparkling white dress, having jet black hair. He goes and sits by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he asks Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "Ya Muhammad, fa'akhbirni anil Islam, tell me about Islam." Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells him about Islam, in other words, the pillars of Islam. And then he goes on to ask him about Iman. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches him the articles of faith, the six articles of faith. And then he goes on to say, "Ya Rasulullah, or Ya Muhammad, fa'akhbirni anil sa'a, tell me about the last hour, or about the day of Qiyamah." Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he knew who this man was, he knew that this man was none other than Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam. So he says, "Mal mas'oolu anha bi'a'lama min as-sa'il," that the one who is being questioned, in other words, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one who is being questioned knows no better than the one who is questioning. In other words, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam are both on the same level, because no one knows when exactly the day of Qiyamah will take place other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. None of us know, not even Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam does not know the world of the unseen. In other words, the world of the unseen about what is going to happen tomorrow, etc., except through what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had revealed unto him, except through what Allah the Almighty had taught him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then the man goes on to ask Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَأَخْبِرْنِي عَنْ أَمَارَاتِهَا. Okay, then inform me of its signs, of the signs of the day of Qiyamah. Now that, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Allah the Almighty had taught Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam many of the signs that are to take place, from the minor signs on to the major signs. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then goes on to say, أَن تَلِدَ الْأَمَةُ رَبَّتَهَا, and in another narration, رَبَّهَا. Now this is the point. This is exactly why I brought this narration. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches the man, teaches the sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, and likewise teaches all of us that one of the signs of the day of Qiyamah is that أَن تَلِدَ الْأَمَةُ رَبَّتَهَا. Now the direct translation given to that statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is that a slave girl would give birth to her mistress, in another narration, to her master. Now scholars have given so many beautiful explanations in regard to this statement. You could take it at its face value, direct translation. But I would say the most beautiful and most striking explanation to that statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would be the explanation of Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah, who says that towards the latter stages, towards the latter stages, when it is close to Qiyamah, tables will turn. Tables will turn. Children will start treating their parents like slaves. Children will start treating their parents like slaves. They will start ordering their parents to do this and to do that. They will not listen to their parents. Rather, they would defy their parents. And this, we see it manifesting itself all around us, especially in today's time and era. And this is from the signs of the day of Qiyamah. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam and the spouse-to-be, it is important for us to understand how important our parents are. Wallahi, I swear by Allah, the ones who have lost their parents, if they were given a chance to go dig up the graves of their parents and take their parents out, they would rush to do so, to bring them back, to ask them for their forgiveness, for all of those harsh words they might have said to them, for all of those rude remarks they would have said to them. Because many of us regret after we have lost our parents. As for the ones who have their parents alive with them, do not waste time. Do not waste time. And why I said it is important that we highlight to the two spouses before they begin their new chapter in their lives is because now they are moving away from their parents. But that does not mean that they forget their parents completely, or that they shun away their parents, or that they start preferring one another over their parents. For that is forbidden in our religion. And remember, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, what goes around comes around. What goes around comes around. I even mentioned this incident in the khutbah, and I don't mind repeating it because it has a good moral behind the incident. This incident took place in, according to the sources that came to us, it took place in Saudi, in Riyadh. There was a man who had a mother and a father, and he had a child. Now his mother passed away. His mother passed away. Now he was married and he was living a good life. He was living a good life. He was a professional, getting a good pay. He had a house, a good car, beautiful wife, lovely child. Life was smooth for him. Now his mother passed away and his father was left all alone. So his father, now old man, he approaches the son and tells him, "Oh my son, I'm all alone. There's no one to look after me. Is it all right if I come and stay by you? I hope I'm not burdening you, but is it all right if I come stay by you?" Now deep down it was a burden. He did not want to accept the responsibility, but he knew it was upon him. It was something that he could not say no to. So he agrees and he brings his father home. Now his father was an old man, and we know what happens in, you know, when people attain old age. He started grumbling for every little thing, and even though it would be hot outside, he would go off the air conditioner saying that it is cold. He started messing up on the dining table, spilling food, because due to his old age. Now the young girl, this man's wife, thought, you know what, I can't take this anymore. I can't have my father-in-law breaking all my expensive crockery and things like that. She goes up to her husband and tells him, you know what, it is either me or your father. I want you to take your father out of my house or out of our house. I don't want him to be here. Now the young boy, even though he's not supposed to do that, he listens to his wife. He listens to his wife. He goes straight to his father and tells his father, Dad, listen, this is the thing. It's tough for me to keep you in my house because you're breaking up all my expensive stuff and all these things is difficult. And we have a driver's quarters outside. You know, in those countries, they have driver's quarters within the same compound. So he said, I'm not putting you out of my house per se, but I want you to go stay in the driver's quarters. I want you to go stay in the driver's quarters. The father's heart was shattered. But he did not want to impose on his son, because he already felt that he was a burden to his son. He quietly agrees. He packs his bag and moves to the driver's quarters outside. Days pass, and now the relationship between the son and the father had gone so bad that they would not meet one another, not communicate at all. The food was sent through the maid. The maid used to go and give the food to the father who was in the driver's quarters. Now each time this young girl, this man's wife, used to send food for him, she used to send it in a ceramic plate, and he used to break the plate often. So she decided, why waste my expensive crockery? Let's just give him a melamine or a plastic plate which he cannot break. So she started sending the food in a shabby plastic plate. After a few days, the plate started to look yellow and old, but she did not care. The food was going back and forth in a plastic plate. Now after a few days, what happened was, now there's no one to look after him, no one to wash his clothes. He used to wear the same dress or the same clothes for 1 week and then leave it there. The maid used to come wash it and give it back. So days pass by, and one day the maid goes to give the food to the old father in the plastic plate. She opens the door, and lo and behold, the old man, the old father, is sprawled on the ground. She screams, oh, the old father has passed away. She cries out, and everybody comes running. The daughter-in-law comes happy, good riddance. She comes happy, he has passed away, so good riddance. The son comes running, oh, my father has passed away. He goes straight to the driver's quarters, he opens the door, and that's the first day he is entering into where his father was. He was disgusted by the sight that greeted him. He saw the old clothes in a corner, food spilled all over the place. The plate was thrown over the corner. His father sprawled on the ground. He was disgusted and taken aback. He called his driver, he called his maid and asked them, you know what, don't touch anything. Just bring the garbage bag and take all these clothes and put it in the garbage bag. Don't touch it, it's disgusting. Now whilst he was instructing the driver, whilst he was instructing the maid, his young son runs into the room. His young son runs into the room, goes straight for the plastic plate and hugs that plate. Now the father, the young man, the minute he saw that, he said, son, leave that. It's a disgusting plate. It is a plate that has not been washed for God knows how long. Don't touch it. Just leave it. It's haram upon you. Just leave it. Just leave it. He started shouting to the young boy. But the young boy said, Dad, no. I want to have this plate. I want to have this plate. And very stubbornly, he's hugging onto the plate. The father is saying, leave it. I don't know how much of bacteria and germs might be on the plate. Just leave that plate. Just leave it. The boy says, no, Dad, I want to have the plate. And he was hugging it. Finally, the father said, okay, why? Why on earth do you want to have this dirty plate? The son replies, Dad, when you become old, I want to serve you food in the same plate. What goes around comes around. What goes around comes around. We want our children to respect us, then it is upon us to respect our parents. The minute the father heard this from the child, his heart shattered. He runs to his father. His father who has passed away, He hugs him and starts kissing him. But it's too late, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. It's too late. And like I said, if any one of us were given the chance to go see our parents now, right now, if we have lost our parents, we would run. We would run and dig up their graves and take them out and hug them, kiss them and ask their forgiveness. So how lucky are we who have our parents right beside us? It is important that we do not be negligent of the value of our parents, because they are two massive doors for us to enter Jannah. Allahu Akbar. They are two massive doors, our parents. It is important that we not be oblivious in regard to their huquq, in regard to their rights. It is important that we respect them. And look at the ayah I recited in the beginning. وَخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّا. Allah the Almighty has decreed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed that you are not supposed to worship anyone other than Allah. لَا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّا. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And that you're supposed to be good unto your parents. And then the ayah goes on, وَخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ. And lower thy wings of submission and humility with mercy unto your parents. The scholars of tafasir, they write that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ. Lower your wings. Have we got wings? We haven't got wings. And why has Allah the Maker used such profound words as saying, lower your wings? Scholars of tafasir, they say that if your mother or your father calls you, she calls you, do not go walking, do not go running, but rather fly like a bird to her immediately. Fly like a bird to your father immediately, immediately. Do not delay, do not delay. Lower your wings of submission and humility through mercy. Allahu Akbar. وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. And pray for your parents. Pray for your parents. Pray for them just as how they, Ya Allah, have mercy upon them, just as how they looked after me when I was young. Just one small narration, I'll wrap it up. A man goes to Umar radiallahu anhu, and he tells Umar radiallahu anhu, Ya Umar, I have an old mother who is so old that she cannot relieve herself on her own. I carry her perhaps to the plains or a field or wherever it is for her to relieve herself. I wait until she relieves herself, and then out of respect I look towards the side and I clean her. I do this on a daily basis. So have I fulfilled the rights towards my mother? Have I fulfilled the rights towards my mother? Umar radiallahu anhu replies, no, you haven't. You haven't even fulfilled the right for one contraction she felt during her pregnancy. Not even one contraction. Allahu Akbar. And then he goes on to say, but what you're doing is good, so persist in what you're doing. And then he says, what you're doing now for your mother, you're doing it, you're doing all of it, it's fine. Your mother did all of that for you when you were young. When you were young, she did all of that for you, hoping that you should live longer and longer, hoping that you should live a long, fruitful life. But you, on the other hand, you're doing it for your mother, hoping that she will pass away tomorrow. Hoping. Many children who look after their parents during their old age, somewhere down there it comes out, you know, I hope she passes away tomorrow. I hope she goes away tomorrow. I hope my dad leaves tomorrow and relieves me of the burden. Many children cannot even face it. They go dump their parents in old age homes. They go dump their parents in old age homes. Allahu Akbar. Not even one contraction she felt during her pregnancy, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. This is how important it is for us to value our parents, respect our parents, and look after them with utmost love, affection and sincerity. For it is through that, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we will insha'Allah ta'ala secure high, high stations in Jannah. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins, and may He forgive the sins of our parents. May He accept all of our good deeds, and may He bless the nikah that is about to take place in a few minutes. May He bless both the spouses. May He bless them, and may He fill their hearts with pure love for one another, and may He unite them forever and ever. And may He bless them with beautiful children who will be obedient and a coolness to their eyes. And may Allah the Almighty unite all of us.